All right, we have an unboxing today. And no, it's not a leaf blower. This is an amplifier that a customer sent me. Oh, and by the way, this is Brad, the Guitologist. You should be watching this on the Guitologist YouTube channel, not on some other guy's YouTube channel who has decided to clone my entire channel. Weirdly enough, I've reported him like 5 times now to YouTube, and they're not doing anything about it. So I guess go clone all my shit. It's open season. Anyway, we're going to open this box and discover what lies inside. Again, I'm expecting a little amplifier, series filament, and this should be a K703. I've done a couple of videos in the past of the K703, so I'm familiar with the amp, familiar with the circuit, more or less. And barring any kind of surprises, this should be a fairly easy thing to knock out here. Good job packing. This is a good example of what to do when packing. He's got the whole thing surrounded. He had padding on the top and the bottom also, so that on all sides it was protected. So we are going to keep all of this stuff to send back with the amp. I'll try to keep my daughter from busting all these. Busting all the bubble crap until then. Definitely a good job, and you can see here he's got the insides stuffed as well. That's exactly what you want to do. So that way nothing that's in there can move around. Your cord can't flop around and puncture your speaker. Your tubes, which I'm assuming that's what that is, probably, are protected. And so, yeah, let's get the tubes in this thing. Get it up on the bench. We're gonna install a isolation transformer in this thing. And if that sounds like something you'd be interested in, please stick around. All right, here's this K out on the bench, and all of my research in the past has pointed to these little amplifiers being made by a company called Radionic Industries in Chicago. Radionic Industries is actually still in business, and they make lighting ballasts. I actually have called their company before to ask them if they knew anything or about their history or had any, you know, old documents from their 60s operations where they were building amplifiers, and they sounded on the phone like they didn't know what the hell I was talking about. I talked to a secretary, and, you know, she didn't know, and I said, well, is there anybody in the office who was there back then, you know, that might know something about the history of your amp building? And she said, well, hang on a second. And she went and talked to, the owner. And he said, no, that wasn't them. They never did that. And I was like, well, I actually have your name on schematics that say the opposite. Radionic Industries, Chicago. Surely there wasn't another Radionic Industries in Chicago in the 60s working, you know, alongside your company. So anyway, I kind of let it drop there. But long story short, they just didn't know anything about it. I think the current owner bought it in 1970 or 1969, something like that. So he wouldn't know anyway. But anyway, here is the back of the amplifier, and if we're lucky, there might still be an intact schematic in here that actually has the Radionic Industries written on it, like I've seen with some of these, and we'll take a look at that here in just a moment. All right, we're getting into this thing now, and a couple things that we notice with the back door off, right off the bat, the back door is actually made of a plywood and not some press board or cheap, crappy material. That's probably because that stuff hadn't, maybe that stuff hadn't been invented yet when this amp was made, or maybe it was still in the developmental stages or something, who knows, but we don't have any of it here. We also don't have any of it on the baffle. The baffle's actually real plywood as well. So that's a plus in my book. The speaker, I don't see it. Well, yeah, I do see a code on the speaker. It's 465, so this would be an Oxford 531, so 31st week of 1965. And the transformer here is dated 1965, 23rd week. I don't know if you're going to be able to see this or not, but yeah, there you go. You can actually see the tube designations there. Weird set of tubes in these case. You see it in a few other differently badged amplifiers from Radionic Industries and maybe some other producers as well, but mainly Radionic Industries. Use the 18 GD6A, the 60 FX5, and the 36 AM3. That's a very common set of tubes for them to use in their series filament amplifiers. Another thing to note about Radionic, these at least K amplifiers built by Radionic Industries is their little badge with the model and serial number here on the bottom. And you'll see this one, the full model number is 703C. 34068 is the serial. That's probably not going to tell us anything at all, helpful in terms of dating or anything like that. You know, a word about serial numbers too. It's such a weird thing. A lot of people are, you know, they'll cover those up and they'll be all weird about them when they're showing them. You know, I usually do that as a courtesy. Something this old, it really is not going to matter that much. But, you know, on newer stuff, it's, you know, I do it and I'm not even really sure why, you know. Oh, I'm not going to show you guys the serial number. I guess so. If somebody tried to report you to the police and said, hey, I've had this such and such thing stolen, here's the serial number. But they would still have to produce some kind of document, you know, surely proving that they actually did buy that amplifier or that guitar with that serial number. So I don't know. Anyway, we do have a schematic, but it's really dusty. Let's clean the schematic off and see if we can make heads or tails of it. All right, here's the schematic, and I don't really know how much we're going to be able to tell about this, but we'll do our best. You can see over here on this side, as with all Radionic Industries amplifiers that I've ever seen, this is kind of a good indicator that you might have one of their amplifiers, actually. If you see this kind of layout in a schematic with all of the parts listed over here on the left and the schematic over here on the right with the tube chart. And if you look also, you will also see some other information like a warranty statement, license notice, how to order parts, that sort of thing. And right at the top, you'll see a model number always. So that's what we have here, a model number, license notice, that it's AT&T licensed from way back in the day. And that license is just pertaining to tube technology for amplifiers in general. How to order your parts. Here's a parts list. So you would need all of these for reference when you look at your schematic. And then you'll always have a, you know, UL insignia at the bottom. Let's see. This one was actually issued to K Musical Instruments Company. That's the safety inspection listing. Was issued to K, and I don't see any other indication. I might as well document this before this corner falls out off. That's all it is. It's just a little number. So this one, unfortunately, does not say Radionic Industries on it. It's actually a bit later than some of the ones I've seen that had that on there. And I don't see it listed anywhere else. I think it actually would have been listed right down here, where it talked about Underwriters Laboratories, who they were given the this certification to. At any rate, that's the thing about vintage amplifiers. You know, it's hard to identify something just by one example. If you looked at just this one example, you may, you know, you may conclude that K Musical Instruments Company made this amplifier, but I assure you that's not the case. K didn't make their own amps. Neither did Harmony. So the two biggest, pretty much the two biggest inexpensive guitar makers in the United States did not make any of their own amplifiers. They farmed pretty much all of that stuff out. And, you know, I'm sure there will be other people who will disagree with that assessment, but I'm pretty confident in saying that is the case. At any rate, this is not really telling us anything useful about the maker, so let's go ahead and pop the thing open, give it an inspection, install the isolation transformer, and do any kind of service or maybe even modifications that are necessary. All right, here's the bottom of the amp, and there is a metal plate on the bottom of the amp, and it's held on with just three screws. The other side is just bent around the outer chassis. So we're going to remove this and see what the guts can tell us. I mean, I guess I could just plug this thing in and fire it up and see what happens. See if we get any smoke out of it. I'm not so sure if that's a good way to go when this isn't my amplifier. The owner might be, he would watch this video and go, oh my God. Okay. Let's see. Yeah, this looks 100% original to me. This little transformer right here, let me see if we can zoom in on that. That little transformer is an isolation transformer, which isolates the preamp filaments from the other filaments for the preamp tube. We have here a electrolytic capacitor, multi-section. Looks like it's a 40, 40, 30, maybe. I might be missing one. The band over the top of it. No? Well, imagine that. They actually provided space so that the band could fit between the lettering. That's kind of cool. Very thoughtful. I very much appreciate that. That's Ajax brand, by the way. I'm sure they will love to hear how much I appreciate their spacing there on their band, so I could actually read all that. But it's, anyway, it's 40, 40, 30, and the, I don't know if there's anything else we can glean off of that. Maybe a date code somewhere, but we'll see. 150 watts or volts on the first two and 25 volts on the third one. That'll be a bypass cap, probably for the power. So yeah, let's go ahead and replace these caps for sure, and probably the coupling caps while we're in here, or this coupling cap, anyway, and kind of go from there. First thing I always do when recapping one of these is just come in and clip the wires off, and we're going to leave this in. Just in case somebody down the road wants to see what the original one looked like, we'll just leave it. It's not going to be in our way anyway, I don't think. Unless we end up wanting to put our isolation transformer over there, which we very well may. In that case, we may get rid of it. But at any rate, the first thing I like to do on stuff like this is just clip these wires. They're marked on here. You can see red is a 40, yellow is a 40, blue is this 30. and black is your common, and there's our black. So, you know, that gives us a roadmap for exactly what to do. So we're gonna leave these wires and just replace those one at a time with the electrolytic capacitors from the wire point to the common. All right, here's the isolation transformer we're gonna use. As you can see, I've already wired everything up. This has some exposed leads, so I'm doing my best to both shrink tube all these connections and tape them up really well. So in case somebody does, for whatever reason, reach in the back of the cabinet, they won't get electrocuted. And that's the other thing. There really is no good place to on the chassis to put one of these up on the middle chassis, not on the inside or the outside, really. So it's going to have to go down here in the bottom. At least the one that I bought will not fit. The dimensions are just a little bit on the large side. So we're going to put this in the bottom of the cabinet. It's going to be fine. We're going to run our leads there to the primary from the wall, and then run them up out of the transformer. All right, I've got the new isolation transformer in. I've got the new caps installed, ground cord, all that good stuff. The isolation transformer is back there, and it's installed pretty much the only place I felt I could get it in there. It wasn't gonna go up here on this chassis. Oh yeah, this cord is this is actually shrink tubed, but I just put some tape on it for good measure. So don't think that I just taped the cord. I wouldn't do that. These caps are okay. I've actually fired the amp up. Everything seems just fine. This cap is actually just isolating the input anyway. And then the rest that are in here are ceramic type, and this is just a that's just a tone cap, so really not critical. The critical caps are ceramic, and they're just fine anyway. So everything's ready to go. Electrically, it's good. So we're gonna give this thing a test and see what it sounds like. Okay, I've pretty much done with the service on this thing, and we're gonna do some modifications. I've actually already done some modifications. The first tube, the V1 preamp tube, is grid biased normally. That's the way it comes stock. But I've actually gone ahead and cathode biased it so that we can dial in, more easily dial in the tone that we want. Right now we are setting the setting the bias on it, and we're with for that purpose we're going to use a decade box. That's this thing right here. This basically allows us to adjust the bias using whatever resistance we choose. Right now I've got it set on 150, which is about where I think it's it should be. But I'll show you the difference that biasing a preamp tube can make. Pretty vast difference, actually. Let's see. All right, here's the setting that I think is going to be pretty good. You can see there it's got some real nice overtones. You can hear my pinch harmonics whenever I do. Nice classic rock tone there. You wanted to cool it down a little bit, make it a little less a little less grindy, you can change the resistance. That's going to basically change the bias point. Um, might be hard to tell on the video, but I can tell it here in the room that it's got a little bit less of those overtones. Sorry. A little bit fewer of those overtones. The pinch harmonics are not quite as squealy, for lack of a better word. Let's try. I'm gonna pop it on up to 1K. And the bass has become a little bit flubby. It's a little bit of a warmer sound, but the bass is flubby. Let's go back to 100. Not sure what happened to my decade box there. I think I need to clean it. So that's 100. For a second and see if I can clean this decade box. All right, here we go with the same sort of concept. I've gone ahead and soldered in my 47 ohm resistor, which is what I settled upon from our tests. Now we're gonna select a capacitor, and I think this is gonna probably take a pretty low value capacitor, just something to beef up the output and the bottom end just a little bit. And we'll see, first of all, here it is without a capacitor. And now here it is with a 0.01 capacitor, or let's start with a 0.1 actually, capacitor. Thank you. Now, these capacitors are not polarized, and I don't think that really matters so much, really, for a preamp tube. I can tell it's a little bit weaker without that capacitor. That's a 0.22. Let's try something a little beefier, like maybe a 4.7 microfarad polarized. Let me get one of those. All right, this is a 2 microfarad. Do a final walkthrough of all the changes that were made while this is still fresh in my mind. Obviously, we did the isolation transformer, added a ground wire for the third prong of the power cord. On the inputs, we now have three different inputs. We have a 10K on the first input, we have the 22K stock on the second input, and we have a 47K on the third input. We have gotten rid of this resistor that was going to ground. Oop, I need to remove it. We've gotten rid of this from the circuit. We're still going through a 0.05 capacitor to the first grid. We have a 1 meg grid leak resistor. Let me get a pointer. Also, let me turn the amp off. We have a 1 meg grid leak resistor right here. We have now have a cathode biased first gain stage rather than the grid leak bias. We have used a 47 ohm resistor, and we've used a let's see, what is this? This is a 0.03 capacitor. That is a bypass capacitor. What else? Okay, moving through. We've used a 0.047, I believe, is what that was. Yep. 0.047 coupling cap, which is kind of important. The 0.1 coupling cap, which was up here in this position before, was sending through a bit too much bass. We have a bright cap here on the volume. Over here, we have retained the tone the way it was with the the 0.0047 or 0.005 from the wiper to ground. Obviously, we changed our capacitors. I have modified this from a 30 to down to a 20, and I've added some negative feedback. The negative feedback value is 330K for that resistor. It's just enough to kind of pad things down a little bit and make everything really nice without without some of the harshness every now and then, especially on the when you're in this first input. Every now and then you get a little bit of harshness without that bit of negative feedback, which helped it out a bit. So yeah, that's essentially the changes. And this thing sounds pretty darn good. We're going to give it a listen now. All right, we're finally ready to demonstrate this thing. And for the purpose of this demo, I'm going to use my 1989 Charvel 750 XL. So yeah, that concludes our presentation on this 1960s K703. Hope you guys have enjoyed this video. Please hit the subscribe button below to get videos like this in the future. And for now, y'all take care.